up here on this branch, we have a Polychrus gutturosus, this lizard right here. And the first thing I want to point out about this lizard is that you're going to see its color change a little bit over time. These are called Berthold's bush anoles, or monkey lizards, or canopy lizards. They're not actually anoles though. Anoles are from the family Anolidae, and these are from the family Polychrotidae. And these two families can be distinguished by their digital pad morphology. You can see this one is puffing up and gaping its mouth. This is quite characteristic of the species in this genus. These have quite good dexterity. They're quite good at moving around in the branches, holding onto leaves and twigs, and their eyes also move independently, which is why these lizards are often compared to chameleons. What these are feeding on in the trees are insects, leaves, seeds, fruits, and flowers. And they're typically many meters up in the trees, which is why they're called canopy lizards. But despite this, apparently local kids catch them, swing them around by the tail, and then throw them. Today we are in the mountains of Colombia's west coast, and we are looking for Oophaga solanensis. This is a species of orange and black dart frog, and I don't know if it has a common name. I probably should have checked that before making this video. And this is quite a reliable species. We'll definitely see a few. We have our first Oophaga solanensis down here in the leaves, underneath this fern right here. That's this little guy. This frog species is one that was described and delimited in 2018, and its type locality is quite near to here. It's somewhere around Solano Bay, which I am quite near to. And that's what gives it its specific epithet, solanensis. This is one of the many dendrobated species that lives around here. There's also dendrobates, phyllobates, andinobates, and others. And among all of those, this one is the most common species, or at least in this area. Like other Oophaga species, the males of this frog are territorial, but you can still find them in groups, most often in pairs, most likely with no more than one male each. During the day, these tend to be quite mobile and terrestrial. You'll see them hopping around on the ground. Meanwhile, at night, they tend to be more sedentary and sit on plants that are relatively low to the ground. Look at this insect that we have over here under this leaf. This is Mimetica castanea. Oh, there it goes. As you can tell, this is a leaf-mimicking species. But this genus specifically, Mimetica, is quite well known for taking its crypsis a step further. Instead of just mimicking a simple dead leaf, you can see that it also mimics the lichen that grows on these dead leaves, and it also has a transparent spot in the tegmina here. And lastly, as you've probably already noticed, it's not completely bilaterally symmetric. It has these kinds of folds in its tegmina. Despite having these wings that are asymmetrical and somewhat folded, they do still fly quite well. Unless it's a species of Celadophila that lives out here in the canopy, there's a good chance that this Mimetica castanea is the largest leaf-mimicking species that lives out here. These two genera that I just mentioned, along with some others, form the subfamily Pterocrosinae. These are collectively known as neotropical leaf katydids, and they're one of the most consistently cryptic subfamilies in all of Orthoptera. We have a little Chironius grandisquamis juvenile on this dead branch here. Here it is. In English, these snakes are commonly known as the big-scaled Sipo, and in Spanish they're known as the conta. However, there's a chance that this refers to more species than just this one. And this juvenile that we have here is quite different than how it will look as an adult. The adults are almost jet black, and they can attain over 2.5 meters in length. The name big-scaled Sipo is quite an appropriate one, as these might have the lowest dorsal scale count of any colubroid snake, and that dorsal scale count is just 10. This is a completely diurnal snake, and much like others like Mastigodryas and Oxybelis, they sleep coiled up in branches at night, usually at least a couple meters off the ground. Despite this snake having that racer build, it feeds primarily on frogs. That said, it does prey on a variety of other things as well. This is one of two Sipo species in the area. The other one is Werner's Sipo, Chironius flavipictus. This is a species I've encountered a couple times in the past, and it looks quite different from this Chironius grandisquamis that we have here, both as an adult and juvenile. Our second Oophaga solanensis is underneath this leaf right here. You can see part of it from here. There it is. Might be hanging out here because it has some water that's standing on this leaf.
The paper that described these in 2018 also described Oophaga histrionica, andresi, and anchicayensis. And these four new species, along with Oophaga lehmanni, which was an already established species before 2018, form one taxonomic subgroup within Oophaga. And within this subgroup, the frog that is most closely related to this one is Oophaga andresi. And like most Colombian Oophaga, this species is endemic to the Choco region, specifically the upper Choco, and known from four general localities. I'm thinking that if more areas in this region were easily accessible, then many gaps in their distribution would be filled in with further sampling. This endemism to the region, along with other factors, has given it the vulnerable status from IUCN. This is a fairly large species of Oophaga. They can attain a length of 4 centimeters. Species in the genus Oophaga can be broken into two size groups. South of the Darien, they're about 4 centimeters, like this one, and west of the Darien, they're about 2 centimeters in length. This here is some of the best Oophaga solanensis habitat that is around, and the main reason for this is that you can see the ground is completely covered in these ferns. The trees are not very dense, that's not really required for this frog, but they really do like areas where plants on the ground are packed quite tightly, and for some reason, they have a preference for ferns. I'm not quite sure what it is, but they're disproportionately found on them. These also like places with a lot of shade, and this area that we're in right now gets very few beams of direct sunlight, which is what these frogs prefer.
Look at this little guy down here, a small toad. This is Atelopus spurrelli.
These toads don't have widely used common names, but some of them translate from Spanish to green harlequin toad or the Choco harlequin toad. And I do want to point out that the name harlequin toad most often refers to Atelopus varius, but it's used for pretty much the entire genus. These are almost a Colombian Choco rainforest endemic. They're mostly localized in the mountain range that I'm in right now, but they also reach the Panamanian Darien. Where I am right now, near Solano Bay, this is pretty much the only colorful toad species. The majority of Atelopus species that are assessed by IUCN are listed as endangered or critically endangered, and this is one of the only species in that genus that's not, this one being listed as near threatened. And this is quite significant considering that this genus is highly diverse. This species is mostly diurnal. Sometimes you will find them on leaves low to the ground at night, and they are also strongly associated with running water, though it is still possible to find them out in the forest. There's an Oxybelis brevirostris moving up in this shrub here. I am almost certainly going to get bitten when I catch this one, but let's see. Yeah, I'm going to have to do this off of camera. Well, I did end up getting bitten multiple times by this snake here, and I think I even got envenomated on my right hand, though I'm not too sure yet. This is actually my first time getting bitten by an Oxybelis, which is a little bit ironic because the last time I caught them, I was saying that I had never been bitten by this genus. Like I've mentioned before, these Oxybelis are well known for gaping their mouths and always being ready to strike. Despite this behavior, I still have not been bitten by one. Anyway, this is Oxybelis brevirostris. It's found in Honduras, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama, Western Colombia, and Western Ecuador. And this is a species that's relatively common at low elevations. I've seen several of them around here, most of which were spotted at night. These are mostly inactive at night. They're most often seen coiled up in vegetation about a few meters off the ground. These are mostly arboreal and feeding mostly on frogs and lizards. And that specific epithet, brevirostris, roughly translates to short nose, which I do think is quite noticeable in this Oxybelis compared to other species that I've seen. The one that we have here is a juvenile. They can attain over a meter in length. We have our third and final Oophaga hopping around down here on the ground. These Oophaga solanensis are almost always the inhabitants of primary forest, but can on some occasions be found in secondary as well. These have a strong preference for areas where there are a lot of low plants covering the ground as well. As I was mentioning earlier, one of the best plants that might indicate their presence are ferns. And unlike some dart frogs, these are not associated with water. In fact, I haven't seen very many at all near moving water. These are known to feed on ants and termites, and apparently they do not feed during the day. And when they're not active, they're typically hiding in the leaf litter, as opposed to inside holes in the ground. At this point, you might have noticed that the orange spots on these frogs are not fixed. These frogs are quite variable. From one frog to another, the ratio of orange to black might be completely different. There are some that are almost completely orange. Well, that will be all for this video of looking for Oophaga solanensis near its type locality. Hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.